Heavenly Father, we come before you rejoicing over your goodness, over your faithfulness. Thank you that you hear the prayers of your people, that you answer, and that we have a hope and we have a help, that no matter how bad things get, you will never leave us nor forsake us, and you will surround us with your favor, protect us, and keep us. Jesus, we just pray now that this will be a blessed day, and that every person that has come will receive from your Spirit life and strength. We receive these things now in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Glory, glory, I give you glory, glory, Jesus, I give you glory, glory. set me free. I give you glory, glory. Thank you.
higher, because He is our help. He's the one that sustains us and keeps us. And greater is He that's in us than He that's in the world. And no weapon that's going to be formed against us is going to prosper. But we have to stand our ground. The snakes are out there, and they want to bite you. But they can't have you because you've got your snake boots on. Huh? That's right. If God's for us, whom shall we fear? And the answer is no one. No one. You may be seated. All right. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord, is it not? It is. Father, anoint your word now. Let it go forth with strength and power. Touch each of our hearts, and I thank you for it. Amen. Had the privilege of speaking Wednesday night to the men's group. And I had just come off hearing the governor's State of the State address. Anybody else hear the governor's State of the State address? That's kind of what I thought. It was the first State of the State address I've ever heard. And I was just home and happened to be going through the channels, and it had just started, and I was getting ready to hit the button and move on, and the Holy Spirit kind of arrested me and said, no, listen. And I realized that our governor, Governor Christie, has been in office long enough to alienate whole segments of our population, specifically correctional officers, state police, police in general, because of actions taken with their pay and different things. But I listened, and he was extremely impassioned about one thing in particular. He spent a long time dealing with it. And it had to do with the drug epidemic that is in our state and is also across the United States. The governor quoted a figure that last year in New Jersey, 1,600 people died of drug overdoses in our state. That's more than was killed by homicide, more than was killed by car accidents. Nationwide, 50,000 Americans died of drug overdoses. Now, if you put that in some kind of a context, in my figures, I'm not certain on this, but I recall in the Korean War, we lost like 40,000 troops. Vietnam, we lost 65,000. Vietnam War lasted for 8 years. In 1 year in the United States of America, we lost 50,000 of our citizens to drug overdoses. Our law enforcement officials, many of them now carry in their cars with them an antidote for a drug overdose that if they can get to the person in time, they can give them a shot. What's that called? Narcan. They can give them a shot of that and they'll live. The governor said over 10,000 units of that was used in the state of New Jersey last year. 10,000. Our county of Cumberland has seen our share of people being destroyed by drug addiction. The devices of the enemy are meant for one thing and one thing only, and that is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Anything that comes out of the enemy's camp is sent to steal, kill, destroy. Steal, kill, destroy. I don't care what it is. Whatever the lust of the flesh that the enemy uses to draw you is being sent to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Jesus came so that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And He gave you the weaponry and the truth that you need to be successful as you have to engage the flesh and the demonic spirits that you encounter. You are to win. You are to be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. The enemy will come out against you one way. He is to run before you seven. Now, you have to make a decision. I have to make a decision. We have to make a decision. I believe in God. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe that God raised him from the dead. I believe that he is seated at the right hand of power. I believe he has given us his covenant and his word. I believe to the point that I am going to do what he says to do, and I am going to flee iniquity and have nothing to do with evil. In fact, in Romans, I am commanded to hate that which is evil. You probably all have heard of MADD, M-A-D-D, Mothers Against Drunk Drivers. I bet none of you here are as mad as the mothers who have lost their child to a drunk driver are. They hate alcohol because it took their child. But do we have a passion in our hearts against that which is evil? Or do we have to wait to somebody we love, somebody close to us, is destroyed by a particular device of the devil, and then all of a sudden we're against it? Why can't we just raise up and do what the Bible says and hate that which is evil, have nothing to do with it, walk away from it, not walk away from it. It says flee. And that word flee means run as in terror. Touch not the unclean thing. Don't touch it with your body. Don't touch it with your mind. Don't touch it with your spirit. Take authority over it and drive it out. We are a clean people. We are a holy people. Holy is the Lord. The cherubim go around the throne daily, all the time, singing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty." And we are his handpicked, chosen, anointed, blood-washed people to be his representatives in our time. Now are we the sons of God. Now. Now are we ambassadors of the kingdom of God. Now are we the people with the answer. Now are we the people with the authority to drive out devils, to heal the sick, and to set the captives free. Now, not in the sweet by and by. Now, now are we the appointed ones of Almighty God. Now, you and me. Say, we know you are, Pastor. I know I am too, but so are you. This is the thing that the Lord's been dealing with me on this week. My job, Ephesians chapter 4, to teach the saints and to prepare them for the work of the ministry. My job. To prepare you for the work of the ministry. And this is a working church. This is not a church where the people just come and they sit on their hands. Almost every one of you in some capacity or the other are functioning in this engine called Fairton Christian Center. I read Romans 12, where it talks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. I read 1 Corinthians 12, where it talks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, but also the body of Christ. Can the ear say to the eye, "We don't need you"? You don't need your little finger? You don't need your thumb? You don't need your toes? The toes perform a pretty important function when it comes to balance and keeping you to be able to walk straight. There is no part of your body that was put there by accident. It was all there for a purpose. And when that purpose is diminished, then we're diminished. I don't care who you are. God called you. Jesus spent his blood for you. He washed you. And he said, now, not in the sweet moment, now are you the Son of God. You are called to do the work of the ministry. Now, we got all these precious young people that have been taught lies absolute lies, starting with the fact that there's no God and we are here by accident through evolution. That's the ultimate lie. Because if you can convince people that there's no lie, then there's no truth. No truth that is absolute. It might be true today, but it might not be true tomorrow. And our young people have been infected with this lie. And because of it, when they begin to have the right to make decisions, and they will make decisions, you don't want a 13 or 14 or 15 or 16 or 17 or a 21-year-old or a 25-year-old that can't make decisions. You want them to make decisions. They want to make decisions. They want to determine who they're going to date. They don't like you trying to figure out who they're supposed to date. They want to determine where they want to go for entertainment. They don't want you telling them what to do. You say, well, they're gonna. Yeah. But there's an awful lot of them do a lot of things that you don't know about. They're going to make decisions. So, the answer is you train them up in the way that they should go, and when they're old, they won't depart from it. You got a 17-year-old. You got a 19-year-old that's in college. They're going to be invited to do things. They have to have the wisdom to be able to say no, because what you're going to do there is something that I am commanded to hate. I am commanded to hate drug addiction because it is sorcery and it involves demons. And these demons are going to come and they're going to do what they always do, and that is steal, kill, and destroy. And I do not want to be stolen from. I want to be the one that is blessed. Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. You know what that says to me? The scornful, the sinners, the ungodly are not going to be blessed. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. In his season. There's a season to things. There's not apples on the apple tree all year long. There is a season. And you're not out doing miracles every day. But there will be a season when the Spirit of God will use you. Some to sow, some to water, some to harvest. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Beloved, I wish above all things that you would prosper and be in health. John says, I am so happy because I know my children are walking in the truth. Why? Because you will know the truth, and the truth will cause you to walk in freedom, in blessing. You'll not be entangled. I love that chorus that we sang about the name of Jesus. It breaks the chains. It leads us out of darkness. It causes us to be able to receive what he has for us. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. When the righteous are in control, the people rejoice. But when the wicked are in control, the people mourn. The wicked shall not bear rule over the righteous, lest they be forced to do evil. It is God's will that we pray for those who are in authority, so that we may have peaceful lives, and that the gospel can spread easily and readily. Why? Because it is the gospel, the good news, that gives people hope, that gives them a reason to live, that brings the blessings that God intended for mankind into the lives of themselves and into the lives that they love and into the lives of their friends. And you are that example. You are living letters that people read. People don't care much about what I say. People don't care a whole lot about what you say. But they read you like a book. And if they see your kids being blessed, if they see the hand of God's favor, the people of Abraham's days, the heathen, saw that. They said, this man's got something on him, around him. God said, Abraham, people that bless you, they'll be blessed. People that curse you, they will be cursed. Are you or are you not children of Abraham? Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons had Father Abraham, and I am one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord. Right hand. Okay? You're it. Read Galatians 3. Jesus took the curse of the law so that we could be of the seed of Abraham, and that the blessings of Abraham might come upon us. So anybody that blesses you, they're going to wind up being blessed. Anybody that curses you, you need to pray for them, because the enemy is coming to take them away, ha-ha, to take them away, ha-ha. And it's the demons that show up and say, aha, 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 where are you? That's what it says in Psalms. Come on. You're the ones. Now, you got friends. You got neighbors. You got people that you come into contact with. Be a Christian. Love them. Invite them over. Invite them over for a piece of upside down pineapple cake. You say, well, I don't bake one. Well, then have Mrs. Zimmerman bake you one and send you. Living Bible says, oh, the joy of those who do not follow evil men's advice, who do not hang around with sinners, scoffing at the things of God. But they delight in doing everything God wants them to. And day and night are always meditating on the laws and thinking about the ways to follow him more closely. They're like trees along a riverbank bearing luscious fruit each season without fail. The Amplified says, blessed. I love this. How you doing, Pastor? It's kind of long. And people, they don't know what to do with it, but how you doing, Pastor? Well, I'm blessed, happy, fortunate, prosperous, and to be envied. Psalm 1. 1. And they kind of go, oh, yeah. Or you can just shorten it up. How are you? How you doing, sir? I'm prosperous. End of conversation. People don't know what to do with that. If you're not up there moaning and groaning and telling them about how sick you are and how bad things are, and how tormented you are, and how everything in the world, you know, it's Murphy's Law. If it's possible to go bad, it's going bad in my life. I'm telling you, I just don't know how I'm going to cope with it anymore. What? Reminds me of, I heard a tape by Brother Hagin, and he was in this church, and he and the pastor was praying, because Brother Hagin was the evangelist, and they're up at the altar, just the two of them, and this pastor kept praying, oh God, somehow, some way, oh God, somehow, some way, oh God, somehow, some way, oh God, Somehow, some way. And Brother Hagin said, I couldn't take it anymore. He said, I got up and went into it and said, Brother, Holy Spirit is the how and Jesus is the way. And you got them both inside of you. Now, the Spirit of the Lord was dealing with me. He wants us as a body to be up and moving for the Lord. We have, I spoke with the ladies group on Thursday. We have a wonderful ladies group that meets on Thursday morning. They always pray. They seek God. They have the word. And I met with them. I said, listen, there are things that you can do as a ladies group, seniors group, that can reach out beyond this church. The Rangers have things that they can do. The Impact Girls have things they can do. Sunday school, we got a great Sunday school now for our kids. There was a time when, you know, Sunday school was hurting. But it's not that way anymore. We have great adult Sunday school. I mean, it's good. Mike's going to teach this morning, and Carol Fresney is making cinnamon rolls. Fresh. And beyond that, you can invite people. We got a great Sunday school class. You ought to come. Got a preacher. It's a little strange, a little weird, but he loves Jesus anyway. We believe that. And we have a congregation of folks. That's just part of it. Jesus called together 70 of his disciples. Then at another time, he sent out his 12. He said, now I want you to go. And said, I want you to pray for the sick. I want you to cast out devils. And I want you to set the captives free. And so they went. And they did. The 70 came back rejoicing. They were excited because they said, even the devils are subject unto us. That's a real exciting thing. The day after, the kid that came to my house that tried to kill me and I saw the power of God knock him flat, I opened the Bible up and it fell open to that scripture and I read it and it said, rejoice not because the devils are subject unto you, but rejoice because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Over the years, the devil's come and tried to torment me a few times, tried to make me think I wasn't even saved and stuff. And I always go right back to that. Oh, no. No, I remember the day that the name of Jesus took authority over your stinking spirits and you went down. And the Lord said that my name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Do you realize that you have access and a right to the name of Jesus? Not me. Don't miss me. Not the board. You. Now, I know it gets complicated. And you can't heal anybody. But Jesus can. The Jesus that's in you. And there is, it's hours worth of teaching. The thing that possesses the blessings of God is faith. And you have to believe. Got to believe. How many times did Jesus say, your faith, not my faith, not some, your faith has made you whole. Now go and sin no more. Why no sin? Because sin is the open door to the thief to come and steal and kill and destroy. That's why you don't sit in the council of the ungodly. That's why you don't hang around with sinners that's going to entice you to do wrong, because they will get you killed. But you have the authority in Jesus' name. You're not healing anybody. Jesus in you. In Jesus' name, I pray for you. And you can fully anticipate a recovery. That's all you can do. You can't make people receive it. You can't cause people, but you can do what God said to do. And if it's a demon, you can absolutely get that out of the person. Absolutely. You can't keep it out, but you can get it out. Lester Summerall, probably, I don't know of anybody that dealt with more demons in their ministry than Lester Summerall, because he spent a sizable portion of time in Central South America and another long stint over in Asia and the Philippines. And these are countries that worship demon idols, and there's much demonic activity. And the best, most outstanding one, Lester was pastoring an AG church, Assembly of God Church in Manila. And he was listening to the radio this one morning, just catching the news, and was talking about this demon-possessed woman that they had incarcerated in the prison that had the power to supernaturally kill people. And the psychiatrists were afraid of her. The prison guards were afraid of her. And nobody could control her. And the Holy Spirit, Lester's just having a cup of coffee, having breakfast. And the Holy Spirit says to him, go down, set her free. And Lester said, no, I don't think I want to, Lord. There's... he said, no, I want you to go. And so he went, and you can do whatever you want. They said, just keep us out of it. We don't want to have anything to do with her. We don't even get close to her. So he goes in, and he deals with the devils that are controlling this woman. He casts them out. He casts it out. And he said he saw the demons. They left the cell, but they were right outside the windows. And he said to them, I told you to leave. And those demons said, you can't make me leave. You can cast me out of here, but only she can keep me out. And so Lester spent the next few hours dealing with her, saying, now listen, you've got to receive Jesus Christ. Remember Jesus said that. Demons are cast out. They go out in dry places. They wander around. They come back. If they find the house all swept and clean, but there's nothing in there, right back in again. And that second thing is worse than the first. So he spent the time dealing with the lady, encouraging her, receive Jesus. These are your weapons. Use the name. Lester leaves, the spirit comes back, tries to get in her, and she had to fight. She had to fight with the name of Jesus. She had to fight the good fight of faith, but she won. And that woman who was demon-possessed and had the power to send demons out to kill people married a Pentecostal pastor and became a Pentecostal pastor's wife, and they pastored the church. You have the authority in Jesus' name to cast spirits out. But the people that you're dealing with have to want to stay clean. You have to want to stay clean. You don't want to mess with evil. You just want to destroy the works of the devil. Jesus was made manifest to destroy the works of the devil. You were baptized in the Holy Spirit. You were saved and born again to destroy the works of the devil. I want you to do it. I want you to take your calling seriously. I want you to go before Jesus and say, Lord, as we start this new year, you didn't call me for nothing. You called me for a purpose. You have a plan for my life. I cannot tell you how I appreciate the ministries of Romans chapter 12. The ministry gifts of helps. The ministry gifts of giving. See, these aren't flamboyant, but these are the gifts that makes the body of Christ function. Giving works around the church. We're going to be surprised when we get to heaven and find out who gets the big crown. Might not be who you think. might be the person doing the mundane things around every day faithfully, faithfully, faithfully. God sees. He loves you, and you have a call in your life. You see how many folks are here today? If each one of us brought a friend to church next week, if each one of us was used of God and we went out and we led somebody to the Lord, where would they sit? We'd have to buy new chairs. And we could do that. It just takes prayer. Lord, Jesus, use me. And maybe they don't want to come to church right away. Maybe they want some personal discipleship. What's wrong with your house? You people sitting here for any period of time, you know more Bible, you know more truth than probably 90% of the people going to church elsewhere do. Don't tell me you can't disciple somebody, that you can't love them. You can. And we will. Because we're a good people. We're a great people. See, you shouldn't say that we're a great people. That was my blessing over the food when I was a kid. God is great. God is good. Let us thank Him for this food. Well, where is God? Last time I read the Bible, He's in you. The greater one is in you. We can do this. In these last days, when our neighbors are dying from drug overdoses, being killed in car wrecks because they're drunk, when their homes are being destroyed because of adultery and fornication, when their children are growing up without moms and dads to instruct them and to care for them, you and I can be the instruments of deliverance for people that we love. We need to ask the Lord for that. Lord, do it. Anoint me, Jesus. Anoint me. And be honest with Him. If you don't care, just be honest with Him. Say, Lord, I don't care. Would you put a caring heart in me? Would you tear off these scales that have formed over me through the years and rip them off and make my heart tender? Make me care about the people that are dying and going to hell. I'll quit with this. H.A. Baker, in his book Visions Beyond the Veil, had this orphanage in China, and all these little orphans got saved, and the Lord began to appear to them. Angels began to appear to them, and they were taken to heaven, and they saw heaven just as it was told in the Bible, and they never heard one scripture about it. And they saw what was there. And these little kids would go out on the streets and they'd witness to beggars and people was there. And then they would have a vision and they would see demons coming to that person and chaining them up, chaining their soul and their spirit up, dragging their soul and spirit out of their body and dragging them over the cliffs into hell. And then they would go back on the street the next day and they'd find the very kid or the very person that they had seen that they had died. Do we understand that people who do not receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior are going to an eternal hell? If you're at home watching by TV and you're violating Psalm 1, you're hanging around with a bunch of horrible people. They've gotten you into the dregs of sin. Your joy, you have none. You have no life. You're just living day to day, hoping to exist. There is something better. There is something much better. There is life and the fullness of it. And it all comes by taking Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. You say, how do I do that? You do it this way. You say, Jesus, I believe in my heart. My head gets confused, but I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. I believe you're alive. And I want you to come and live in me. I give you this miserable life. I give it to you. You can take it and do with it what you will. And I confess you with my mouth right now as my Lord. I make you my Lord, Jesus. I accept you as my Lord. And I thank you that you have forgiven me of all my sins and that I am a new creation. If you prayed that prayer, would you call us? Because we have people waiting to hear your call. And because this is at the end of the program, we're going to ask them to wait another 15 minutes, longer than they normally do. Make Jesus your Lord before the enemy comes and destroys your life completely. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for these good people. I thank you for this wonderful church. I thank you that they are called to be ministers of your gospel, ministers of your truth, to set the captives free. Help us, Lord, as we approach this new year, to be a place where the Holy Spirit is free to move, where we come to church clean already because we have spent time with you. And Jesus, we give ourselves to you fresh and new to be used for your kingdom. Thank you, Lord. Amen.